Sonic Speaks. His company can be found at perfectlynormal.net, but is anything but normal. His lists of incredible shows are voluminous and include, but are not limited to, Ben-Hur, Judge Dredd, The Gemini Apes, Batman Nightfall, and most recently, Good Omens. When asked of who inspired this generation of new age of modern audio drama enthusiasts, outside of old-time radio, Douglas Adams, and the NPR Star Wars, there's one consistent name on the tiller who everyone agrees. He's the Steven Spielberg of radio drama, and our guest tonight, Mr. Dirk Meggs. Dirk, it's a real thrill for me to speak to you. How are you doing?
I'm fine, Jack. It's really great to speak to you. Thanks for having me aboard, and please excuse my very blocked nose.
Not a problem. You have such an incredible list of shows. Do you have a formula as to how long a production takes from the beginning to the end?
No, I don't really. Generally speaking, I calculate per half hour is a day in the studio recording actors, which sounds like an incredible luxury to some people who try and get like 2 hours done in a day. But I try and work to half an hour a day, half an hour final running time means a day in the studio with the actors. But then can mean up to 2 weeks in post for me. I tend to spend a lot of time in post, but that's kind of my rule of thumb, but it's not for everybody, I know that.
So that's every half hour. So if you're going to have a very long production, that could mean, you know, a week's worth of recording.
Yeah, I mean, Good Omens was a week. Good Omens was, 7 days in the studio?
Right.
Yeah, seven working days. I kind of work a combination of the old way of doing things and the new way. The old way of doing things where you had the actors actually standing up, working to a mic and moving around, you know, using a room, using the space inside of a room to create the illusion of movement, because they really are moving, as well as miking actors in a static position and then moving them in post. But if possible, I try and keep actors standing up and moving around. It stops them falling asleep.
Well, that's one thing that I wanted to talk to you a little more when we get into the acting side of things, because I know that there's cartoons that often record actors in total isolation, and you can hear it in the cartoons. They don't interact, but you like to have the actors all together, don't you?
Yeah, I do. I really try and work ensemble if I can. I have done animated films and TV. Did the animated Mr. Bean with Rowan Atkinson, and I did a first draft of a film called The Magic Roundabout. And yeah, you know, I have worked with individual actors on their own, but I just don't feel that the chemistry comes across in the same way as it does if you've got two or three actors on a microphone working together, especially if they, quite often they know each other. On Neverwhere, Neil Gaiman's Neverwhere, did a couple of years ago, you know, mm-hmm. we had Benedict Cumberbatch and James McAvoy mm-hmm. On the same microphone working in a scene together, and it means the chemistry the two guys are playing off each other. I mean, the outtakes are great as well, you know. So two friends who are working together and know each other's strengths can really, you know, you get to see a sort of great game of verbal tennis, if you like, with the dialogue as the ball. So, I would always try and work ensemble. I know it's not always possible. I know a lot of people who do audio drama for fun, audio theatre for fun, especially in the United States, tend to do it over long distances with people kind of phoning their lines in. And that sometimes is the only way to do it. But if at all possible, get a bunch of people in a room, feed them at lunchtime, give them plenty of coffee to drink, and wind up and let them go. You get some amazing things.
Now, when I have people come here to record in my place to do some shows, I feel the same way. I love having them here for the energy that's involved. But to keep the lines sort of pure, I often have them wait a half second before they do the response. Do you have problems with that bleed over from one line to another, or do you try to do the same thing and keep them sort of separate even though they're all there?
No, I don't. I let them overlap each other if they're in the same scene together. That's acting for me. If it's a scene where somebody interrupts someone else, I'd much rather they actually interrupted them. And sometimes it can result that, you can get a surprise out of it. If I'm miking individually and I've got to add a load of sound effects, or I'm dropping someone into some kind of acoustic, I'll just say, can you just leave a kind of cigarette paper's width of gap that I can get an electronic razor blade in for the edit? But no, I try not to make them think about how they're riding the bicycle. I just want them to ride the bike, I
Sure.
want them to be. It's like, if there's too many road traffic signs or too many changes of speed limit, you're not actually concentrating on driving well, you're just concentrating on not doing the wrong thing. So I try to give actors as much freedom as possible, because the more things they have to think about, the less of a performance I'm getting.
That's a really good point. I know that you said in another interview that you try to sort of get them to go ahead, turn the page altogether, and that way you don't have to worry about people turning them separately, because that can be a problem with sounds too when you're recording.
Yeah, absolutely. If you're going to have some inevitable thing that is likely to screw up what you're trying to do, then it's better to let it screw up in an organized way than give yourself nightmares in the post.
Well, let's start from the beginning with writing. What makes it an award-winning audio drama script in your mind?
The same thing that makes any good script, it needs to tell the story economically, effectively, and with a sense of ongoing purpose. What I find very depressing is when people think that audio theatre involves voices talking to each other in silence and conversations that take place in static situations. That's for TV or any other medium, or theatre maybe, where you're locked into one location. For us, audio is the most flexible of the media. You can go anywhere and do anything. You can be inside someone's head. You can be out in the, you can be a universal eye. You can do almost anything. So when I see scripts or listen to pieces where, for no good dramatic reason, two voices are basically having a conversation about events that it would be much more interesting if they were being depicted, I get very frustrated. It's thinking there are limitations on this medium. The medium is seen as a sort of poor relation, which is inevitable, really, because it doesn't command huge budgets, and it does tend to be overwhelmed by the visual image. But in fact, it's infinitely flexible, and a good script really should never, ever, ever worry about what are seen to be the limitations of the medium. In fact, a good audio script should really read like a good film script. There should be a sense of forward movement, there should be forward propulsion, there should be gripping characters. There should never be a moment where you feel the thing is treading water or having to catch up on previous events. When we did the Batmans and the Supermans, the Spider-Mans and the Judge Dredds, these were 3-minute episodes which were slotted into a music program which had, was playing top 40 material. So basically, we had 3 minutes slotted between two other 3-minute items, each of which would be a piece of music, Madonna on one side and Kanye West on the other, for the sake of argument. Records on which thousands, hundreds, tens, hundreds, possibly thousands of dollars were spent to make them. And there we were with an $800 3-minute segment, and we had to hold our own. And I very quickly learned, when I was adapting those comic books, that what you never ever did was sit characters down and talk to each other. You get those characters off their asses, you get them moving through the world they live in. If you have backstory to tell, tell it while you're moving on to the next location for action. Have Instead of having Batman and Robin in the Batcave discussing things against a cold, dead background, have the Bat computer in the background spilling out the names of the bad guys who've just escaped from Arkham Asylum, or have Batman in the Batmobile. I mean, you get the sense of what I'm saying here. Never, ever, ever give in to the think that the need to fill the audience in on where you are in the story means that you have to sort of stop everything to do it. There's nothing worse than stopping the action. You can write. This is the great thing. What people don't get about this medium is you can write a movie and shoot a movie without a camera in the room. if you want to do that, you've got to remember it's got to obey movie rules. You don't have to read your Robert McKees and your Sid Fields and all of these, script doctor guys, but there are some basic rules. When you go and see a movie, what do you go and see? You want to see something that doesn't bore you, hopefully tells you a great story, and maybe makes one or two moral points along the way. Well, that's exactly what we could do in audio. You don't have to sit two people down in chairs, tie them in chairs. Well, maybe tie them in chairs is not a bad idea.
It's interesting because Jeanette Kahn, who used to be the president of DC Comics, I don't know if she still is, but I remember years ago she said
She
that.
was in Superman on trial. She was one of our witnesses.
Oh, that's fantastic. Oh, yeah, she said that comics were the ultimate, creative form because you could destroy a planet in one frame and recreate it in a second. And I always thought that comics and audio drama were like right on par with each other as probably the most creative mediums to be able to do that kind of work. And yet, like you do bring up some fantastic stuff, and your stuff just screams that kind of action. But the traditional radio dramas that are most popular are the mysteries where they're in the drawing rooms, are the, those kinds of horror stories that aren't necessarily filled, or dramas that aren't necessarily filled with a lot of mind-blowing special effects. How do you figure that?
Well, some people just like this sort of traditional stuff, but then that's, it's like watching a Hitchcock film. If you can stand to watch exteriors shot indoors and driving shots in cars which are unmistakably back projected, if you like that sort of theatricality, then that's great. Enjoy. There's plenty of stuff out there. There's, what is it? We now 90 years worth of radio drama. Recorded that you can enjoy. I'm not criticizing it, but that's not how I see the medium being best used. But even if, I've done Agatha Christie detective mysteries. I've done stuff like that. I think really it's creating a convincing world is the thing. That I believe is the most important thing. And I just, it's talking heads. If Poirot pulls all the suspects into a room at the end of the drama, if that's your thing, if that's what you really enjoy, then fine. They're all in the room and he goes around and tells everybody why they're either guilty or innocent. But not for me. But that, I'm not criticizing it. But what I'm saying is the medium has so much more going for it. That you don't have to feel you're sitting in some kind of virtual theatre. You can actually go into a world. And if that world is portrayed with depth and a feeling of reality, really, that's what this medium can do. And people don't know that.
I love what you said, and again in another interview, because I've always said it, that if you can write a really powerful radio drama as a show and produce it, then it is its own sort of an envoy for a possible movie. Because if it can work really well in radio drama, and it could be nowadays done really visually as a movie as well.
Well, I often say to people who poo-poo audio is the sort of, the lesser medium. If you want to be a writer of films, indeed a director of films, but you want to find out whether your ideas work, it's you can very quickly use audio to run a movie script and put it together and see if the images suggested by what you hear are sufficiently compelling to then go to all the trouble of getting a camera in the room, getting a lighting cameraman, getting costumes, getting sets, getting this, getting da, 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 da. You can very quickly, a lot of people who want to write movies are unaware of the fact that you can actually do this in audio first. But that's not why I do it. I don't do it as a because I hope it'll be made into a film. I do it because I know the medium's better than film. But that's just the secret that people like me who work in this medium know. That's why I don't work in film, because film is such a literal medium. And although I love movies and my greatest pleasure of an evening after a day of mixing an audio thing, the last thing I want to do is go and listen to another audio thing. I'll go and plop my ass down and watch an episode of Mad Men or whatever it is, I'll go watch your stuff. I'm a big movie fan, and originally I intended to get in the movie business, but by one weird reason or another, And in fact, I spent time in Toronto on a film set in the late 70s. I know how to load a Panavision 35mm camera. It's a skill that seems to be much in demand these days. But I was there. I did that stuff. And then I realized that all the things I really wanted to do, it's very unlikely I was going to get direct movies about Superman, Batman, Judge Dredd, Spider-Man, and so on. I've directed movies about all those guys and had a lot of fun doing it, given, I think, pleasure to a lot of people doing it. And there was never a camera in the room, not a Panavision, that's for sure. So I'm a very lucky person. But on the other hand, I work. There's no such thing as luck, but there's plenty of hard work. But this is a great medium, and what I obviously, we're doing this chat to you, and it'll go out, and I think it will really go to people who we're preaching to the converted, as it were, people who understand that. But you know what? It's what I loved doing Good Omens recently was that on Twitter people were saying before it aired, "Oh, I wish they'd make a movie. Yeah, it's only radio. I wish they'd make a movie." And then after the first, episode goes out, they're going, "Wow, this really was like a movie." And they suddenly kind of get it because they've sat there and let the movie play across the screen of their mind, and they get that it actually can be done.
You're a man after my own heart, sir. I'm just smiling from ear to ear. It's great to hear you say that, because I feel the exact same way about writing radio drama. What should you never do, though, when you're writing a script? Because you've written a lot of these scripts yourself.
Well, you should always use verbs. That's for, really, script no verbs, that's tough. There's a joke there, actually, Jack. You never do. Never bore yourself. If you bore yourself, you're going to bore the cast. If you bore the cast, they're going to bore the audience. And if you've got a bored audience, nobody's going to want to have it. And there's a kind of, I do have the "am I getting bored" thing. For example, let's say I've been given a very, very well-known book to adapt, which has happened, and I get to a passage in it that I find dull compared to the rest of what I'm doing, which can happen. I'll be freely honest about it. Then I see that as a kind of fun problem. Okay, I've got to get this scene across, or the information in this scene across. How can I do it in such a way that I'm actually having fun writing it, and the actors are going to have fun playing it? And that way you get some wonderful moments, where actually you're surprising yourself by finding ways to tell the story you hadn't thought of. So as soon as I'm getting bored, that's when I know I've got to go in a different direction.
When you're doing adaptation, and I've done adaptations too, the trick is finding the most important scenes to make sure that you tell the story. The scenes that everybody's going to expect to be able to be in the story, the scenes that tell the story the most, because once you get it into an audio, there's no way you can usually do the entire book from cover to cover. What makes you, do you have a good correspondence with the author to make sure that you get it right in their vision, or do you go strictly with your own?
Well, it kind of depends on whether the author's still alive or not, or you need a Ouija board. With Douglas, bless him, no longer with us. But then I kind of keep a for Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, I kind of had a virtual Douglas in my head. I kind of knew
Well,
from
it helps that you knew him, right?
that's the thing. I mean, that did help. But I've been very lucky that people have trusted me with things. And in the case of Good Omens, I did get to talk to Neil and Terry, bless him, about it, and was able to ask questions. But at the end of the day, Neil is, he's got, this is 20 years old for him. So, and he's got projects to do now. So I don't want to bother him about, a question if I can think of an answer myself. So the first thing to do is, trust yourself. And secondly, generally speaking, the seeds to the answer to any writing question are probably in what you've already written. There is, when you get writer's block, or you get to a point where you know that I had to get this scene in, but I don't know now I've got to this scene, I don't know what the heck to do. usually, going back and reading through the stuff you've got already will give you a clue as how to tackle the problem. The big set pieces in any book, and sometimes you think, "How the hell am I going to do that?" In Knightsbridge, in Neverwhere, you know, there's this description of this huge structure, and they have to cross it. Well, you know, it's bloody hard doing an audio representation of a bridge.
That's true. Yeah.
And if what I didn't want to do, I'm a bit allergic to having a narrator. I just kind of don't like, I don't like, I think a narrator is a cop out. I know that that's a little bit harsh, but I try to avoid doing a narrator. And so for Knightsbridge, I had to find a way to get it in the dialogue. And in the end, I think the dialogue and the music carried the sense of this vast span over this abyss sort of thing. But it's that sort of, you know, these are challenges, but you know, that's part of the fun of doing what we do, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. And I'm glad you brought up narrator because that's one thing that I always struggle with too. Because as soon as you have a narrator in a story, you're telling what happened in the past, and you're not living with the immediacy of the story. So, but on the same level, it's really difficult, I find, for myself writing things like fantasy, which require sometimes an awful lot of description to, or at least some ways of being able to paint that picture. So if you're doing a Tolkien-esque kind of story with a world that people maybe have never seen before, it's very difficult to get like a fight scene in somebody's head without having some kind of narration or description going on.
Yeah, that's true. But you know, that's part of the fun and the challenge of it. And sometimes you have to have a narrator. I mean, Hitchhikers has got the voice of the book, which, you know, is as much a narrator as it is a sort of sidebar to the
Yeah,
action.
and Batman has a little speaks to himself a bit in Nightfall at times, for
You
sure.
know, and that was really the kind of the thinks bubble from the from the comic books. But the thing about Batman, I would say, or rather, when we started it with Superman, was that originally, it was the first time I ever adapted a piece of comic book, you know, sort of action into audio. I thought, well, I'll just take what's in the speech bubbles and I'll turn it into dialogue, and I'll take what's in the thinks bubbles and way to get it in, you know, and all of that, and I'll add some noises and see how that works. And I very quickly found that actually they're incredibly overwritten. They're really overwritten. And if you do that, they're so turgid. In fact, I was listening just the day before yesterday. Somebody posted up on Facebook a thing about a company who are doing a certain extremely large comic book company's product. I won't go into details. And there was a trailer for it, and it had the big music, and it had the loud people shouting in reverb, deep reverb, and the occasional explosion. And you know, it was kind of sort of full-on audio movie type thing. And I thought, okay, yeah, you know, that sort of sounds like they're trying to do something. And then I went to the site to actually listen to a clip rather than the trailer, listen to a clip from the actual piece. And there was about 8 hours of this stuff, and it was pretty much, I would, it sounded to me like about 80% narration, 20% lines thrown in, and the odd sound effect, and the whole, the narration was this sort of, they came over the hill, their guns blazing, the sand below the beat under the sun, and all this stuff. And it was like, I just thought, wow, you know, no wonder they could turn out 8 hours of this stuff, because there's absolutely really very little thought gone into how to make it exciting, because it's all just given to a bloody narrator.
Yeah, this is
So,
like an audio book with sound effects, not audio drama.
yeah, which is, you know, there's a place for everything, you know. But
Absolutely.
I seriously thought that's a hell of a cop out, really, when you realize what can be done with audio. No, I was disappointed.
I was thinking Chuck Dixon wrote the original Batman Nightfall, and I've been a huge fan of his action-packed story style way back, even back when he wrote the Airboy remake, which would be a great audio drama, by the way. Did you get a chance to talk to Chuck before you did Nightfall at all?
I spoke to Denny O'Neill mostly.
Oh, Denny, cool.
And so, because Denny was sort of editor in chief. Denny, I spoke to in the same way that I was speaking to Mike Carlin when we were doing Superman. And so, basically, I talked to those guys, or Scott Peterson. I spoke to Scott about Batman, because I do remember, because occasionally I'd ring and he wasn't in, and then his voicemail would kick in, and it had Mark Hamill as the Joker as his voicemail, which was very cool. These guys, I did refer a lot to these guys, and really they were very useful. Useful is not the word. They were bloody wonderful, because they allowed me to ask all sorts of questions, and I still have, you know, lots of notes from Mike, for example, Carlin.
Right.
This guy is great. When I sent an audition tape of Kerry as the Joker, or he would say Iron John in Superman Lives. Iron John. He don't make him sound too a character where he shouldn't sound too much like a thug. He's a civilized guy, or whatever it was. You know, there's this sort of feel that we needed to get.
Yeah.
And these guys were great. And the thing is, if you work with people who really love what they do, they will give you that bit extra. And if you show them that you respect it as well. And it's rather sad these days, because although I know there are a lot of people in the comics book business who really love what they do, respect mm-hmm. what they do, I feel that something's been lost over the years now. It's a more corporate thing. And, I would love to revisit Gotham City or Metropolis or wherever, but sadly, I don't think the lawyers who now control the allocation of rights would get it the way that these guys used to get it, which is sad.
It is,
or rather,
sad.
They get, if they get a lot of money out of it, yes, turn out 8 hours of narrated stuff, and we'll let you have the license. And I'll say, I'll do that.
No, it's too bad. You know what? Denny O'Neill, if there's anybody who knows Batman, it would have been Denny O'Neill. He's done much work with the Dark Knight, so that was good. I've said publicly and often, and even to you, that the actor who plays Joker on Nightfall beats out my thought of Mark Hamill's portrayal for me. He has this more reasonably mad way of presenting Joker. did you have the idea of the news commenter reading the credits under the threat of the Joker when you wrote the script, or did that come in after you started recording?
We did. Well, in fact, what we did was on the very first Batman. On the very first Superman on trial. It ended with the credits were Lex Luthor reading through a list of people he was going to take to court for defamation. So it kind of grew from that. So whenever we did credits after that, we always looked for an angle. And the Joker harassing Lorelei as she attempted to read the credits straight was just too good to miss. But no, it's all ad lib. You see, that's one of those occasions where if we hadn't had the actors in the room at the same time, they wouldn't have been able to play with it that way. You
for
know,
sure. Now, I have not listened to your Superman series, and I'm aching to, because I'm a big Superman fan as well. So I'm looking forward to listening to Superman trial.
They're the oldest thing, you know, so you'll have to forgive some finding of the feet, but I'm proud. I'm still proud of them.
You've worked with some amazing stars. You mentioned Rowan Atkinson, Leslie Nielsen, Spike Mulligan. Okay, so who was the funniest? Who's the funniest?
Oh, geez. You see, who's comedians don't tend to be being funny when they're not on.
That's true.
It's hard. It was a dream come true to work with someone like Spike, because he's such a legend in radio comedy here in England. You know, I mean, if it was the Goon Show, there never would have been Monty Python and so on and so forth. So, you know, he's a huge influence. All I can say is it's been a real pleasure. I suppose who's funny. You know, there are comedians I've worked with, like a guy called Roy Hudd, who's a real British musical type comedian. I did when I was, still quite new to the business, did some radio series with him. And I think I learned everything I know about doing radio comedy and doing and writing comedy from him. But we had some enormous laughs together. But comedy tends to be a serious business. If anything, I think the straight actors I've worked with on stuff like the DC comic stuff, that's when we've had more laughter. I mean, certainly Batman Nightfall, I have to say, there was more honest to goodness falling about laughing doing that in between takes. So in fact, there were some outtakes on the re-release we did a few years back, the remaster, and you get a sense of just it was just crazy and very funny. But you know what? The best people to work with are the ones who are secure about their talent because they won't give you a hard time. If they see that you're trying your hardest, and you know, and you don't need help, you're going to be all right. And if you do need help, they'll help you. And if you don't need help, they'll enjoy themselves. And that really is a compliment to you, but B, also, it's a test of them. You know, when you work with the big stars or the names, and they turn out to be a little bit petty or mean, or they pick on the lowest person, you know, on the least important person in the room, and so on and so forth. Like a runner gets told off because something isn't the way it's meant to be. Then, you know, you can tell that person actually isn't such a big person themselves. They're not such a big star in themselves. But I'm happy to say all the people you've mentioned actually are really, you know, fine human beings.
What are your memories about Douglas? Because I think Douglas Adams was the guy who solidified it for me in the early 80s, listening to the original Hitchhikers.
I mean, the thing about Douglas was that I didn't expect to hear from this guy. And, you know, this was when I joined the BBC in the late 70s, The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy had only just gone out, and everybody was talking about in radio was saying, look, this thing's completely rewritten the rules. These guys have turned radio comedy around, and it's become something utterly amazing. And I sort of listened to it, and at the time, you know, I was new, and my intention was to get straight into television. I mean, radio was just a stop on the way. You know, I got in the BBC, and that was my, you know, big deal. I totally, you know, didn't think I was going to stay. And when I heard it, I thought, oh yeah, okay, Doctor Who with jokes. And I kind of didn't really listen to it. And then I used to do night shifts, part of our as a sort of a radio technician, a studio engineer. You know, we'd end up doing night shifts and what have you. And that was when we used to listen to stuff. If it was a quiet night newsroom, there used to be loads of tapes to listen to, and Hitchhikers was on these reel-to-reel tapes, so we put one on. And then I began to realize what an achievement it truly was, and what an absolutely magic and fantastic thing. I got great respect for it, but by then it was a TV show, and then he just went on and wrote these other books, and it never went back to radio. They did two series on radio, and then it sort of disappeared. And then he was trying to make the movie, and you know, all these things. So I sort of thought, oh, well, you know, you know, it's gone away. And then you know, I was doing Batman and all that stuff, or Superman rather. And we'd just done Superman. And my boss, he rang me in my office, the head of Radio Light Entertainment, which was the department I worked in, sort of rang and said, have you got half an hour this morning? And I said, yeah. And he said, because I've just had a phone call from Douglas Adams, and he's interested in knowing whether you'd be up for producing some new series of The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, because he's heard your stuff and he thinks you're the sort of guy who might make a good go of it. So you could have knocked me down with a feather.
Oh, for sure.
I was round at Douglas's kind of, you know, before he put the phone down almost, you know. And it was a fantastic thing, you know, that he'd asked me round, and he was kind enough to say this to me, to think that I was good enough to do it. So I just, you know, I obviously was very keen, and the actual path to making it was a pretty labyrinthine. You know, it wasn't easy. It took, you know, 10 years to finally get the thing off the ground, and various adventures we had. But seriously, I think it was the moment which, interestingly, kind of turned me around from just doing the comic books into actually doing, well, I would say straight science fiction, but that's not right. You know, it's
Sure.
not a straight science fiction, but it is seriously trying to create audio movies. Yeah, that would be it. So yeah, it really, really, well, completely turned me around. And I was very privileged to to have his trust.
How do you go about casting? Do you write with people in mind, or do you like to work with the same people, or do you have your own little bucket list?
No, you know what? It's funny. In the old days, casting used to be the sugar coating or the pill of all the hard work that went into doing the show. But over the years, I've kind of stopped worrying about casting, especially with the recent stuff we've done with the Neil Gaiman and Terry Pratchett stuff, because Heather, who produces it, and you know, sort of we work as a team on it, Heather does a lot of that, and she's very good at getting these amazing people. I just try and make sure that any character in the script, and this is sort of an important thing for writing anything, if you're involving actors, no matter how famous or obscure, the good actors will work. Even the good actors need good script. They can't turn bad script into a good performance. So what I try to do is just write for the character on the page, the character from the book, and make it as interesting and fun as I possibly can for them, so that they're not just going through the emotions, you know. Mm-hmm. When we did Neverwhere, James McAvoy, we had a read-through, table read with all these amazing actors, you know, around this table, Christopher Lee and James Benedict, Sophie Okonedo, you know, Ramona Garai, all these guys, Natalie Dormer from Game of Thrones. It's just so cool. But of course, you know, everybody was there doing a job and so on, but at half time, for when we broke for lunch, James came up. He said, you know, episode 3, he gets really, he's just whinging. He's always moaning. You know, can't we do something about that? Does he have to be always so reactive, you know? Uh-huh. And I absolutely had noticed that myself. And I thought, yeah, we can. And it was great to have James, who'd actually sat and thought about it. You get input from the actors as well. But no, it's working for the character, thinking who's going to be in it. You know, that is a massive, you know, that kind of masturbatory thing of oh, wow, I can work with so-and-so. You know, to be honest, that's the last thing in my mind is when this amazing, whoever this amazing actor is, the lines had better be good enough for them. Otherwise, I'm going to look like an idiot.
Well, I know my co-host and maybe the busiest actor in the world of modern audio drama is David Ault, and he wants to know the best way to get on a Dirk Meggs show. So I guess talk to Heather is the best thing, right?
Yeah, or buy Dirk a pie. That's always a good one.
Buy a pie. Do you have a favorite kind of pie?
No, pint.
Pint. I thought you said pie. Yes, a pint. Well, that's easy enough to do.
This is England. We drink pints.
There you go. What's your favorite beer?
Oh, anything with alcohol in. A nice warm English beer, that's what I like.
I've often thought that writers, directors, producers in movies have probably the closest to audio drama producers in the way they get that opportunity to complete their vision. So do you have to be a bit of a control freak to really appreciate this as much as I do?
No, I don't think so. I'm not really a control freak, because I like to let things happen. I like to let the chemicals react on their own. People who direct micromanage their cast will only end up with what they envisaged getting in the first place. Whereas people who let their cast play with the material can often end up with something where the sum is much greater, the whole is greater than the sum of its parts.
Yeah.
I like to let people play with stuff.
So you don't mind if they change the script as long as it makes it better?
Oh, within reason. I mean, you know, if it's Neil Gaiman and Terry Pratchett or Douglas Adams, if they want to paraphrase a classic line, I will stop that happening. But on the other hand, if they want to improve an otherwise rather dull line or find a new way to deliver that classic line, I'm not going to stand in their way. I let them play with it. I like to see recording as a sort of work, as a combined, it's a studio session, but it's also workshopping.
Yeah, you know? Me too. I feel the same way.
Because otherwise, what's the point? You might as well have bloody robots doing it. And, you know, actors, hopefully, are intelligent, creative people. And they might bring something to the party you had no idea they could do. I mean, when I offered Kerry the Joker originally, I only had a shrewd idea he could do it. I didn't know he could do it. He didn't go around doing that. And then he came back with his performance. It's like, wow, this really, you know, this is much better than I thought. You know, much better. I mean, Kerry's a good actor. I knew it would be good. I didn't know it would actually be defining. And it really was. And actually, the joke was, you know, the first in Batman, the Lazarus Syndrome, which was the first time he did it, he just had one paragraph. It's just a single one-page speech from, you know, and as you pull out your imaginary camera, you know, you reveal that he's behind bars in Arkham, you know. You just start with this cold, that's where you do start with a cold voice, and gradually, you know, you pull out and realize this is, he's locked up, thank goodness. When we did Nightfall, Kerry was off the leash. I mean, he was just brilliant. And I mean, my favorite bit of Nightfall is the Joker's movie, which is in the later part.
Yes.
Where Kerry's playing, you know, there's all this stuff going on. It just, oh man. It was
absolute madness in the best way. It was
in the best possible way. Funny.
Absolutely. And I love the read-throughs almost as much as anything else when I'm with the actors, because I'm watching them to see which things that click with them and which things I need to sort of make adjustments and changes to, for clarity as well as for fun. Yeah.
Well, the read-through, the table read, you know, sometimes I wish I'd recorded it, because, you know, sometimes you never get that back. And we did it. I've just done a play that's going out Monday week, which is about this British astronomer called Patrick Moore, who I actually knew quite well. He was a wonderful eccentric. I have to say that the table read on that was just to die for. I've never seen normally sober actors fall out laughing as they were doing read. And it was a reasonably straight play. So it was actually very, very good. So, it's wonderful. I love actors. I love actors and musicians, because the best of them will give you everything. Because they want it to be right. That's the best ones. The ones who come, who are doing you a favor, I'm very happy if they don't come back. But most of the original ones are there for the joy of doing it.
Yeah, when you get the creative sparks going on all sides, you really can create a fire. That's for sure.
Yeah.
So from the mixing side of things, because you say after you do the recording, you can spend a whole week and a half an hour of doing that side of things. Are the three things, if you could come up with three things, that make a difference between an amateur sounding production and a professional one?
Foreground action, background action, and the scenery. Think in those terms. Create a world within which your characters exist, that exists independently of your characters. The joy of doing Batman was as much in creating Gotham City as what Batman was doing in the foreground. Because how cool. What does Gotham City sound like? You think, what does Gotham City sound like? You know. And how do you then convey that? In sound only. That's the sort of challenge. There is always a world going outside. So foreground action would be immediate Foley, you know, cloth movement and all that sort of stuff. You know, the stuff that happens around people just existing and living and breathing and being. And then the background action is the room they're in, the doors that are opening and closing, you know, the sort of the immediate environment. And then the sort of the scenery is the city skyline beyond, the occasional siren, you know, the occasional helicopter. I mean, it depends on the scene, you know, it depends on the world created. Nothing happens in a vacuum. If you have two voices against an absolutely quiet background, then that should be for a dramatic reason, not because you haven't got the imagination to add a background. If you're going to create a world, if you're going to create characters, then you've got to create a world they live in. If you're going to create a world they live in, don't do it by half measures. So that would be my... And the other thing is, and it's really obvious, is, for goodness sake, try and record your cast in an acoustic that suits the background they are in. The number of times I hear people do stuff where the characters are supposed to be outdoors, and you can hear that they're in a room. You can hear the acoustic, especially when they lift their voices or whatever. This is sometimes professional productions, I might add. Drives me crazy. If you need to do an outdoor scene, go outdoors, for crying out loud. take a portable recorder, or if at a pinch, run the microphone cable out of a window. You know, if you possibly can. Nowadays, there's no excuse, you know. You can record on anything. I did Voyage, this story about a mission to Mars. We did this 15 years ago. And to record the supposed astronauts in the space capsule, we actually put the three people into, you know, boiler suit kind of thing, you know, sort of disposable overalls, inside a people carrier, you know, a sort of, you know, SUV kind of thing or whatever, van thing, out in the car park of the studio. And we mic them on mics from Radio Shack, you know, little, you know, 50-cent mics stuck into styrofoam cups on their headphones. And they could hear the action through the headphones. And so they were in a space capsule. Sounded great. Another thing I heard the other day was, if you want to record a very, very dead voice, like a narrator voice, and you need as dead an acoustic as you would need, as you'd like an anechoic chamber, record someone in a car and mic them very closely. Car is very good. A regular saloon car is a pretty good place to record a voice dead. Stuff like that. Simple answers. Now, we in this day of digits, when you could get a little Zoom or an Eniroll, or, you know, one of these little mics that, you know, it's got a memory stick or an SD card in it, there's no reason why you have to worry about you do have to worry about the dramatic effect you're trying to create, but you don't have to worry about finding a studio anymore. Record it in location.
Right. So it's interesting, because you got foreground, which basically drives the story, and you've got background, which basically is the setting, correct? And mood, yeah. Maybe, too.
Yeah, and then the mood kind of is your scenery, I would say. That's your back. But you know, it's like Disney in the 40s invented this thing called a multiplane camera. They first used it on Pinocchio, and basically they had the animation of the characters on a cell, but then in front of that, around the edges of the frame, they had sort of like a bit of the scenery, and then another layer even closer to you, they had another bit of the scenery. So that as the camera pushed in, you felt the scenery was moving in three dimensions past you. It was like a 3D effect, and this is exactly what I think you could do in audio. You've got foreground action, and then you've got this sort of background around it, and then this big, big scenery around it. And that way you get a sense of depth and a sense of reality.
Wow. Yeah, no, that's true. Max Fleischer did that in some of his early cartoons too, when he was messing around with different stuff. Yeah.
Fantastic. Yeah.
The Hitchhiker's Guide that you had done 3, 4, and 5, but you also took everything on stage. You did a touring of the Hitchhiker's Guide on stage. What are some of the biggest pitfalls of producing a radio drama for a live theater audience?
Well, what we did was Hitchhikers was done by the Radio Light Entertainment Department, which was the comedy department. And what we used to produce a lot of was audience comedy with that comedy department.
Right.
But the one thing that they never thought of doing, or you know, didn't seem to suit Hitchhikers, was to actually record it like that with an audience, where the actors work to microphones in front of an audience, and the sound effects are done to one side, and there's maybe a band to the other, and so on. So really all we did was we just mixed those two things. We said, okay, suppose Hitchhikers had been, instead of being a purely studio thing, had been a live thing. And the reason it wasn't a live thing in those days was because doing the sort of sound effects that they were doing took weeks in the radiophonic workshop, the BBC's radiophonic workshop, all these weird sound effects and so on. Whereas, of course, now we have digital gear that can produce this stuff at the drop of a hat. So it's sort of doing what might have been done then, but was limited, the technology it didn't make possible. So that was really the kind of the logic behind it. And what we did was, the actors stood in front of microphones holding the scripts, and the sound effects were created, and then we had the music and so on. But what we did add was more business. We had, you know, Marvin was actually a robot puppet. And when the Pan-Galactic Gargle Blaster drink was mixed, you know, Phil Pope, who played the waiter who was mixing it, pretended to descend into a sort of, you know, cellar behind the sound effects table. And then you would hear him screaming when he was getting the tooth of the sun tiger. And you'd hear the tiger roaring and him screaming, and rags and bits of cloth flying up from behind his table. table. He'd come out wearing a ragged jacket, you know, brandishing this tooth he's managed to get out of the tiger. You know, this sort of thing. And then we'd have the endlessly poor drink gag, you know, which is actually was a Spike Milligan that I stole. You know, it was an homage to radio comedy, live radio comedy, as much as an homage to Douglas's great creation. And because really, despite its sophistication and the amazing ideas, Hitchhikers at the End of the Day still has plenty of musical jokes in it. It worked very well, and we had the original cast, which of course was wonderful. So, you know, it was surprisingly simple to do. It worked extremely well. In fact, we had some issues with the business side of things, but in terms of the creative side of things and the show on the road and those of us who were with it on the road, it was a huge success, and we had sellout audiences, and it worked very, very well.
Well, you've done so much. So how do you pick your next project? Do you have an idea that something would be fun and popular to do, or does someone come to you with a project that they want to complete?
Well, you know what? I usually pick things on the basis of either I do them or I'm unemployed. That's which I pick. I love it when you see promotion trailers. Well, it's promotional EPK for movies. They say, well, you know, when I was offered this part, I had to think very long and hard. You think, bull crap. You were desperate for that. So I can hand on heart tell you that really I just try and stay employed if I can. You know, the thing is that working with cast, scripts, music and what have you is an expensive business. And, I could have picked other ways to make a living which would have actually earned me a better living. The money usually runs out before the work does, because, you know, I'm spending 2 weeks in post and I'm only paid for 2 days, you know.
But
that's because I love the medium and that's what I do. But no, it's lovely that it's been a success, and it's really nice to be known for quality product. But in terms of making money, really, I should have been an accountant.
Well, then, I guess the big question is, Dirk Max, what do you want your legacy to be in the end?
Oh, millions of pounds.
You don't care if your stuff is remembered?
Oh, I don't think you get to pick, do you? You don't get that choice. I would love people to, if more people have discovered how brilliant it is as a medium, have then played with it themselves because of that, because, you know, they've realised how relatively straightforward it is to create worlds this way, then that would be a fantastic thing. And one thing that I do like is when I go to the BBC, you know, I used to be obviously on the staff of the BBC, and I, 20 years ago I left, but I still work mainly for them. When I go in there and I have people come up and introduce themselves and say, I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for listening to what you were doing and wanting to do it myself, that's a nice feeling. So, you know, that'll do for me.
No, that just this last week, and I couldn't end this interview without having your thoughts. I know we've lost Terry Pratchett, and that's got to be hard, because you just finished Good Omens with him and Neil Gaiman. A beautiful job, wonderful testament to their novel. I loved every minute of listening to it. Waited anxiously by my computer for the next episode to be released on BBC so I could listen to it live, or at least as live as possible. Do you have any thoughts that you want to share with those of us who really loved Pratchett?
I didn't know Terry that well. You know, I met him. I'll tell you the three encounters I had with Terry, if you like, life encounters. The first time was when I was still at the BBC as a radio light entertainment producer. Somebody came in and said, I've got the rights to Mort, and I've got a script, and I'd like to pilot it. And Jonathan, my boss at the time, the same boss who put me onto Douglas, said, oh, well, Dirk's your man. And we did a pilot for a series of Mort. And it turned out this guy did not have the rights, and Terry hit the roof.
Oh, my God.
And the thing was canned, and we weren't allowed to do it. And then about a year later, I was doing a chat show called Loose Ends with a guy called Ned Sherrin, who's a famous sort of producer. He used to work a lot with people like Peter Cook and David Frost. And Ned was the presenter of this show. And we had Terry on as a guest. And I was able to apologize to Terry for this misunderstanding or whatever. And he was fine about it. But what I did notice about Terry then was how driven he was, because any time that he was sitting waiting to go on, or he was even between questions almost, he had a laptop open and he was writing the next book. He was that driven. He was that full of love for what he did. And I was hugely impressed by that. But I also, you know, at that point, you know, realized, as Neil pointed out in a piece not that long ago, you know, Terry wasn't a cozy, you know, cozy gentleman if he wanted to be. Mm-hmm. He could be, you know, pretty spiky. Why not? He created whole worlds and he should protect them. So that was, you know, my second real encounter with him. And then I would see him at social events, because we were both friends with Patrick Moore, this astronomer. And so Neil, Terry and Rob, his assistant, because by then he'd been diagnosed. Mm-hmm. Terry and Rob turned up, and Rob is just such a great guy. He's a terrific person, and he really, you know, kept Terry productive to the end, and mm-hmm. which is what mm-hmm. Terry wanted to do. It wasn't coercing Terry. Right. Terry was desperate to create and having great trouble doing so without help. Mm-hmm. And Rob and Terry used to come to events. So when Patrick celebrated like the 55 years of the Sky at Night, this astronomy program, they were there, and we caught up briefly. But my last encounter with Terry was last summer, when I went down with Neil's last visit, to his place in Salisbury, which isn't that far from us. And we were able to talk about, you know, sort of good omens and so on. And I thought, I'd warned that Terry wasn't great. And I have to say, the first thing we did was record that cameo in the car outside his office, outside his workplace. And, you know, Neil had to feed the lines to Terry, and then Terry would read them back, sort of thing. That's how we achieved, you know, got him to record the stuff, because he actually had a lot of trouble reading by this point.
Right.
And we went in, and I thought, well, you know, you're not going to get much, you know, conversation. But Neil was chatting with Heather. And so, you know, I had a chance to actually talk to Terry. And he was actually very focused at that point. He'd kind of clicked into gear. Mm-hmm. And he gave me one or two quite good, you know, sort of notes about, you know, the tone of the piece and so on. But the thing is, you walked in the office, and this was, his whole world was around him on the walls of his office. It was like Patrick's was sort of astronomy books and signed photos of Buzz Aldrin and, you know, mm-hmm. whatever. And Terry's was full of models of Discworld and Granny Weatherwax or whatever, you know, with all of this stuff, with little figures and the books and the wars and so on and so forth. It absolutely, the place oozed the culture that he had created. Mm-hmm. So you kind of felt that this all came from this. It was like a little monk's cell, but the most richly kind of invested with its legend place, if that makes any sense at all. So I was incredibly lucky to meet him, and I was very sad when I saw Neil 3 weeks ago when we were doing the Douglas Adams Memorial Lecture. Mm. Neil said to me, you ought to know that Terry really, you know, he's about to go. And it was horribly sad. But what a legacy he's left. I mean, tragic, horrible, shouldn't have happened. The guy had 20 books left in him. You know, yeah, 66 is no age to die, all of this stuff. But what a legacy, you know? Mm-hmm. It was,
so many great ones have left. I mean, Douglas Adams, he was, what, 51 when he passed as well?
49.
49. It wasn't even that. It was heartbreaking.
Yeah.
I just wanted to thank you. I know I've taken up plenty of your time, but to me, I feel like I've just scratched the surface. I have so many questions. So we'll have to leave that for maybe another time. Would you be interested another day coming in and having a chat?
Let's do another one. Absolutely happy to. Very much so, Jack. It's been a pleasure talking to you, and I hope it will have been of use, of, you know, in some way or another.
Oh, I'm sure lots of people will be excited to hear this episode. Thanks so much again, Dirk, and have a great day.
This has been an Electric Vicuna production. Sonic Speaks.
His company can be found at perfectlynormal.net, but is anything but normal. His lists of incredible shows are voluminous and include, but are not limited to, Ben-Hur, Judge Dredd, The Gemini Apes, Batman, Nightfall, and most recently, Good Omens. When asked of who inspired this generation of new age of modern audio drama enthusiasts, outside of old-time radio, Douglas Adams, and the NPR Star Wars, there's one consistent name on the tiller who everyone agrees. He's the Steven Spielberg of radio drama, and our guest tonight, Mr. Dirk Meggs. Dirk, it's a real thrill for me to speak to you. How are you doing?
I'm fine, Jack. It's really great to speak to you. Thanks for having me aboard, and please excuse my very blocked nose.
Not a problem. You have such an incredible list of shows. Do you have a formula as to how long a production takes from the beginning to the end?
No, I don't really. Generally speaking, I calculate per half hour is a day in the studio recording actors, which sounds like an incredible luxury to some people who try and get like 2 hours done in a day. But I try and work to half an hour a day, half an hour final running time means a day in the studio with the actors. But then can mean up to 2 weeks in post for me. I tend to spend a lot of time in post, but that's kind of my rule of thumb, but it's not for everybody. I know that.
So that's every half hour. So if you're going to have a very long production, that could mean, you know, a week's worth of recording.
Yeah. I mean, Good Omens was a week. Good Omens was, 7 days in the studio?
Right.
Yeah. Seven working days. I kind of work a combination of the old way of doing things and the new way. The old way of doing things where you had the actors actually standing up, working to a mic and moving around, you know, using a room, using the space inside of a room to create the illusion of movement, because they really are moving, as well as miking actors in a static position and then moving them in post. But if possible, I try and keep actors standing up and moving around. It stops them falling asleep.
Well, that's one thing that I wanted to talk to you a little more when we get into the acting side of things, because I know that there's cartoons that often record actors in total isolation, and you can hear it in the cartoons. They don't interact, but you like to have the actors all together, don't you?
Yeah, I do. I really try and work ensemble if I can. I have done animated films and TV. Did the animated Mr. Bean with Rowan Atkinson, and I did a first draft of a film called The Magic Roundabout. And yeah, you know, I have worked with individual actors on their own, but I just don't feel that the chemistry comes across in the same way as it does if you've got two or three actors on a microphone working together, especially if they, quite often they know each other. On Neil Gaiman's Neverwhere, did a couple of years ago, you know, mm-hmm. we had Benedict Cumberbatch and James McAvoy mm-hmm. On the same microphone working in a scene together, and it means the chemistry the two guys are playing off each other. I mean, the outtakes are great as well, you know. So two friends who are working together and know each other's strengths can really, you know, you get to see a sort of great game of verbal tennis, if you like, with the dialogue as the ball. So, I would always try and work ensemble. I know it's not always possible. I know a lot of people who do audio drama for fun, audio theatre for fun, especially in the United States, tend to do it over long distances with people kind of phoning their lines in. And that sometimes is the only way to do it. But if at all possible, get a bunch of people in a room. And we had to hold our own. And I very quickly learned when I was adapting those comic books that what you never, ever did was sit characters down and talk to each other. You get those characters off their asses. You get them moving through the world they live in. If you have backstory to tell, tell it while you're moving on to the next location for action. You know, have instead of having Batman and Robin in the Batcave discussing things against a cold, dead background, have the back computer in the background spilling out the names of the bad guys who've just escaped from Arkham Asylum, mm-hmm. or have Batman in the Batmobile. I mean, you know, you get the sense of what I'm saying here. Never, ever, ever give in to the need to fill the audience in on where you are in the story means that you have to sort of stop everything to do it. There's nothing worse than stopping the action. You know, you can write... This is the great thing. What people don't get about this medium is you can write a movie and shoot a movie without a camera in the room. If you want to do that, you've got to remember it's got to obey movie rules. You know, you don't have to read your Robert McKees and your Sid Fields and all of these, you know, script doctor guys. But there are some basic rules. When you go and see a movie, what do you go and see? You want to see something that doesn't bore you, hopefully tells you a great story, and maybe makes one or two moral points along the way. Well, that's exactly what we could do in audio. You don't have to sit two people down in chairs, tie them in chairs. Well, maybe tie them in chairs is not a bad idea.
It's interesting because Jeanette Kahn, who used to be the president of DC Comics, I don't know if she still is, but I remember years ago, she said that...
She was in Superman on trial. She was one of our witnesses.
Oh, that's fantastic. Oh, yeah, she said that comics were the ultimate, you know, creative form because you could destroy a planet in one frame and recreate it in a second. And I always thought that comics and audio drama were like right on par with each other as probably the most creative mediums to be able to do that kind of work. And yet, like you do bring up some fantastic stuff and your stuff just screams that kind of action. But the traditional radio dramas that are most popular are the mysteries where they're in the drawing rooms, are the, you know, those kinds of horror stories that aren't necessarily filled, or dramas that aren't necessarily filled with a lot of mind-blowing special effects. How do you figure that?
Well, some people just like this sort of traditional stuff, but then that's, you know, it's like watching a Hitchcock film. You know, if you can stand to watch exteriors shot indoors and driving shots in cars which are unmistakably back projected, if you like that sort of theatricality, then that's great. Enjoy. You know, there's plenty of stuff out there. There's, you know, what is it? We now 90 years worth of radio drama recorded you know, you can enjoy. I'm not criticizing it, but that's not how I see the medium being best used. But even if I've done Agatha Christie detective mysteries, I've done stuff like that. I think really it's creating a convincing world is the thing. That I believe is the most important thing. And I just, it's talking heads. If Poirot pulls all the suspects into a room at the end of the drama, if that's your thing, if that's what you really enjoy, then fine. You know, they're all in the room and he goes around and tells everybody why they're either guilty or innocent. But not for me. But that, you know, I'm not criticizing it. But what I'm saying is the medium has so much more going for it that you don't have to feel you're sitting in some kind of virtual theatre. You can actually go into a world. And if that world is portrayed with depth and a feeling of reality, really, you know, that's what this medium can do, and people don't know that.
I love what you said in another interview, because I've always said it, that if you can write a really powerful radio drama as a show and produce it, then it is its own sort of envoy for a possible movie, because if it can work really well in radio drama, and it could be nowadays done really visually as a movie as well.
Well, I often say to them, feed them at lunchtime, give them plenty of coffee to drink, and wind up and let them go. You get some amazing things.
Now, when I have people come here to record in my place to do some shows, I feel the same way. I love having them here for the energy that's involved. But to keep the lines sort of pure, I often have them wait a half second before they do the response. Do you have problems with that bleed over from one line to another? Or do you try to do the same thing and keep them sort of separate even though they're all there?
No, I don't. I let them overlap each other if they're in the same scene together. That's acting. For me, if it's a scene where somebody interrupts someone else, I'd much rather they actually interrupted them. And sometimes it can result that, you know, you can get a surprise out of it. If I'm miking individually and I've got to add a load of sound effects, or I'm dropping someone into some kind of acoustic, I'll just say, can you just leave a kind of cigarette paper's width of gap that I can get an electronic razor blade in for the edit? But no, I try not to make them think about how they're riding the bicycle. I just want them to ride the bike, you know?
Sure.
I want them to be, it's like, you know, if there's too many road traffic signs or too many changes of speed limit, you're not actually concentrating on driving well, you're just concentrating on not doing the wrong thing. Mm-hmm. So I try to give actors as much freedom as possible, because the more things they have to think about, the less of a performance I'm getting.
That's a really good point. I know that you said in another interview that you try to sort of get them to go ahead, turn the page all together, and that way you don't have to worry about people turning them separately, because that can be a problem with sounds too when you're recording.
Yeah, absolutely. If you're going to have some inevitable thing that is likely to screw up what you're trying to do, then it's better to let it screw up in an organized way than give yourself nightmares in post.
Well, let's start from the beginning with writing. What makes an award-winning audio drama script in your mind?
The same thing that makes any good script. It needs to tell the story economically, effectively, and with a sense of ongoing purpose. What I find very depressing is when people think that audio theatre involves voices talking to each other in silence and conversations that take place in static situations. That's for TV or any other medium, or theatre maybe, where you're locked into one location. For us, audio is the most flexible of the media. You can go anywhere and do anything. You can be inside someone's head. You can be out in the, you know, you can be a universal you could do almost anything. So when I see scripts or listen to pieces where, for no good dramatic reason, two voices are basically having a conversation about events that it would be much more interesting if they were being depicted, I get very frustrated. It's thinking there are limitations on this medium. The medium is seen as a sort of poor relation, which is inevitable, really, because it doesn't command huge budgets and it does tend to be overwhelmed by the visual image. But in fact, it's infinitely flexible, and a good script really should never, ever, ever worry about what are seen to be the limitations of the medium. In fact, a good audio script should really read like a good film script. There should be a sense of forward movement. There should be forward propulsion. There should be gripping characters. There should never be a moment where you feel the thing is treading water or having to catch up on previous events. When we did the Batmans and the Supermans, the Spider-Mans and the Judge Dredds, these were 3-minute episodes which were slotted into a music program which had, you know, was playing top 40 material. So basically we had 3 minutes slotted between two other 3-minute items, each of which would be a piece of music, you know, Madonna on one side and Kanye West on the other, for the sake of argument, you know, records on which thousands of dollars were spent to make them. And there we were with an $800 3-minute segment.
When you're doing adaptation, and I've done adaptations too, the trick is finding the most important scenes to make sure that you tell the story. The scenes that everybody's going to expect to be able to be in the story, the scenes that tell the story the most, because once you get it into an audio, there's no way you can usually do the entire book from cover to cover. What makes you, do you have a good correspondence with the author to make sure that you get it right in their vision, or do you go strictly with your own?
Well, it kind of depends on whether the author's still alive or not, or you need a Ouija board. Yeah, with Douglas, bless him, you know, no longer with us. But then I kind of keep a for Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, I kind of had a virtual Douglas in my head. You know, I kind of knew from...
Well, it helps that you knew him, right?
That's the thing. I mean, that did help. But I've been very lucky that people have trusted me with things. And in the case of Good Omens, I did get to talk to Neil and Terry, bless him, about it, and was able to ask questions. But, you know, at the end of the day, Neil is, you know, he's got, this is 20 years old for him. So, and he's got projects to do now. So I don't want to bother him about, you know, a question if I can think of an answer myself. So the first thing to do is, you know, trust yourself. And secondly, generally speaking, the seeds to the answer to any writing question are probably in what you've already written. There is, you know, when you get writer's block or you get to a point where you know that you, you know, I had to get this scene in, but I don't know now, now I've got to this scene, I don't know what the heck to do. Usually going back and reading through the stuff you've got already will give you a clue as how to tackle the problem. The big set pieces in any book, and sometimes you think, how the hell am I going to do that? In Knightsbridge, in Neverwhere, you know, there's this description of this huge structure, and they have to cross it. Well, you know, it's bloody hard doing an audio representation of a bridge.
That's true, yeah.
And if, what I didn't want to do, I'm a bit allergic to having a narrator. I just kind of don't like, I think a narrator is a cop-out. I know that that's a little bit harsh, but I try to avoid doing a narrator. And so for Knightsbridge, I had to find a way to get it in the dialogue. And in the end, I think the dialogue and the music carried the sense of this vast span over this abyss sort of thing.
Right.
But it's that sort of, you know, these are challenges, but, you know, that's part of the fun of doing what we do, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. And I'm glad you brought up narrator, because that's one thing that I always struggle with, too, because as soon as you have a narrator in a story, you're telling what happened in the past, and you're not living with the immediacy of the story. So, but on the same level, it's really difficult, I find for myself, writing things like fantasy, which require sometimes an awful lot of description to, or at least some ways of being able to paint that picture. So if you're doing a Tolkien-esque kind of story with a world that people maybe have never seen before, it's very difficult to get like a fight scene in somebody's head without having some kind of narration or description going on.
Yeah, that's true. But you know, that's part of the fun and the challenge of it. And sometimes you have to have a narrator. I mean, Hitchhikers has got the voice of the book, which, you know, is as much a narrator as it is a sort of sidebar to the action.
Yeah, and Batman has a little, speaks to himself a bit in Nightfall at times.
Yeah.
For sure.
You know, and that was really the kind of the thinks bubble from the comic books. But the thing about Batman, I would say, or rather when we started it with Superman, was that originally it was the first time I ever adapted a piece of comic book, you know, sort of action into audio. I thought, well, I'll just take what's in the speech bubbles and I'll turn it into dialogue, and I'll take what's in the thinks bubbles and way to get people who poo-poo audio is the sort of, you know, the lesser medium. You know, if you want to be a writer of films, indeed a director of films, but you want to find out whether your ideas work, it's, you can very quickly use audio to run a movie script and put it together and see if the images suggested by what you hear are sufficiently compelling to then go to all the trouble of getting a camera in the room, getting a lighting cameraman, getting costumes, getting sets, getting this, You know, you could very quickly, a lot of people who want to write movies are unaware of the fact that you can actually do this in audio first. But that's not why I do it. I don't do it because I hope it'll be made into a film. I do it because I know the medium's better than film. But that's just the secret that people like me who work in this medium know. That's why I don't work in film, because film is such a literal medium.
Yeah.
And although I love movies, and, you know, my greatest pleasure of an evening after a day of mixing an audio thing, the last thing I want to do is go and listen to another audio thing. I'll go and plop my ass down and watch an episode of Mad Men or whatever it is, you know, I'll go watch your stuff. I'm a big movie fan, and originally I intended to get in the movie business, but by one weird reason or another, And in fact, I spent time in Toronto on a film set in the late 70s. I know how to load a Panavision 35mm camera. Mm-hmm. It's a skill that seems to be much in demand these days. But, I was there. I did that stuff. And then I realized that all the things I really wanted to do, it's very unlikely I was going to get direct movies about Superman, Batman, Judge Dredd, Spider-Man, and so on. Mm-hmm. I've directed movies about all those guys and had a lot of fun doing it, given, I think, pleasure to a lot of people doing it. And there was never a camera in the room, not a Panavision, that's for sure. So I'm a very lucky person. But on the other hand, I work, there's no such thing as luck, but there's plenty of hard work. But, this is a great medium. And what I we're doing this chat to you and it'll go out. And I think it will really only go to people who we're preaching to the converted, as it were, people who understand that. But you know what? It's what I loved doing Good Omens recently was that on Twitter, people were saying before it aired, oh, I wish they'd make a movie. Yeah, it's only radio. Wish they'd make a movie. And then after the first, episode goes out, they're going, wow, this really was like a movie. And they suddenly kind of get it because they've sat there and let the movie play across the screen of their mind. And they get that it actually can be done.
You're a man after my own heart, sir. I'm just smiling from ear to ear. It's great to hear you say that because I feel the exact same way about writing radio drama. What should you never do, though, when you're writing a script? Because you've written a lot of these scripts yourself.
Yeah. Well, you should always use verbs. That's for, really, script no verbs, that's tough. That's a joke there, actually, Jack. Never bore yourself. If you bore yourself, you're going to bore the cast. If you bore the cast, they're going to bore the audience. And if you've got a bored audience, nobody's going to want to have it. There's a kind of, I do have the am I getting bored thing. Let's say I've been given a very, very well-known book to adapt, which has happened, and I get to a passage in it that I find dull compared to the rest of what I'm doing, which can happen. I'll be freely honest about it. Then I see that as a kind of fun problem. Okay, I've got to get this scene across or the information in this scene across. How can I do it in such a way that I'm actually having fun writing it and the actors are going to have fun playing it? And that way you get some wonderful moments, where actually you're surprising yourself by finding ways to tell the story you hadn't thought of. So as soon as I'm getting bored, that's when I know I've got to go in a different direction.